Okay, so why don't we get started? I'll just start with a few housekeeping rules. I know that many of you are familiar, but please keep your audio and videos off. However, I do encourage all our audience members to interact and ask questions to our panelists via the Zoom chat function. And you could also use the chat box to tell us about yourself and to make comments. And we are recording this session. You might have gotten a little notification. So everything will be available for viewing after the event on our website. So again, I want to welcome everyone to this thematic discussion. And in this session, we're going to discuss some effective examples of engaging employers through technologies, using simple technologies that are easily accessible, and some of the issues around employer engagement. So we have a lot to discuss today, and I hope it will be an opportunity for us to spark new ideas and new discussions around career guidance and technologies. So, without further ado, I want to introduce our two wonderful speakers. So we have with us today Mr. Nick Chambers, who is the Chief Executive at Education and Employers in the United Kingdom. And we also have with us Mr. Juan José Juárez, who is the Senior Project Manager at Fundación Bertelsmann, I hope I pronounced that correctly, in Spain. So this session promises to be insightful and informative. But before we hear from our speakers and really get into the discussion, I was thinking that I would get everyone's kind of thinking started around the topic. So I've got a video that I would like us to kind of start off with. So let me see for how I can share my screen and show you. Okay. Let me. Let's see if I can do this. Okay. Sorry about that. Are you able?
This afternoon, we're going to draw people doing.
Okay. So I hope you enjoyed that video. There were some really powerful messages, I think, conveyed through that short clip. Please share your thoughts and reactions in the chat with us, and we'll try to address some of these points later on in the discussion. I guess for me, it was really highlighting the power of breaking down gender biases through employer engagement. And you could see how very young children, it says in the video, as young as 5 to 7, already have these very solid gender biased notions of careers. And this is something that I think schools and policymakers can really help to address by engaging employers. And so it's one of the important roles that employers can play in helping to shape student career aspirations, but also allow young people to have a more expanded view of the world of work. Okay, so enough from me. Let's turn to our speakers. I'm first going to turn to Nick. So Nick, that was actually a video from Education and Employers where you are the chief executive. So can you tell us a little bit more about your work, touching on the importance of engaging employers for effective, equitable, and efficient career guidance?
Yeah, I can do. I couldn't actually hear that. Could everyone else hear it or not? Anyone else? Could anyone hear it at all?
You couldn't hear it.
No. So,
no.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
So, it's slightly better with the sound on.
Can
anyone hear at all? No. Okay. I will resend the link later on. Do you want me to share some slides? Is that,
yes, please. I'm so sorry about that.
All right. And we've got what?
End, but,
10 minutes from me. Will that be
yes.
useful? And lots of questions. All right. Okay. I'll have a bit of a screen share. I've done one or two. Let's just see if this works. Which I hope it does. Right.
And if it doesn't, then I'm also happy.
That's all right. I'm sure.
Great.
Okay. Now, don't worry. I'm not going to have slides with loads of text on that. This is only one slide with lots of text on. There's only about 5 slides. This has got a lot of text on it, but it's mainly really to set the context. So it's really probably to get a screen grab of this rather than trying to read it. There's a lot in here. The main sort of thing, is to look at what our area of issue is, the sort of disconnect between what young people know about the world of work and the world of work itself, how we can tackle that and how we can do it at scale. And you'll see that I feature here largely the report by Anthony Mann. I think we had input in that called Dream Jobs. If you haven't seen Anthony's Dream Jobs report by the OECD, I would highly recommend it. It's a really good report. And obviously all the work at the OECD are doing on career readiness. So on the left-hand column, it's really looking at that children's and young people's knowledge are very much affected by where they live and who they meet, that actually their career expectations haven't changed much over the last 20 years. And in fact, they're actually narrowing rather than diversifying. And again, you'll see that in the Dream Jobs report. And one of the key ways of tackling this is this idea of giving young people the chance to interact with the world of work. So that's what I'm going to talk about. I'm not going to talk about video conferencing. I'm not quite sure where that appeared from, but I'm not going to talk about video conferencing. I'm going to talk about how we show children and young people the world of work and how we can do it at scale and equitable. That was talked before we came onto this breakout session. You know, how do we make sure that those children who have least support can get access, not just those in affluent or affluent areas who've got very high social capital. So what we wanted to do is to make something that was really simple for teachers, and I'm going to show on. So it's a lot on that slide. As I say, I'm not expecting you to look at it in detail, but it's mainly the disconnect, tackling the disconnect, and be able to do it at scale at low cost. So we came up about 12 years ago. We sat down with employers, and we sat down with the government and charities, and in fact, actually, JP Morgan, one of the first funders of Inspiring the Future, so it was great to hear what they've been doing just now, using a CRM system called Salesforce, which many of you may be familiar with. It wasn't so familiar 12 years ago, and it makes it really simple, and we've developed it and refined it. I think we've rebuilt the technology 4, maybe 5 times, and then we've shared the technology with other countries who've replicated it in either the same form or slight variants of it, because at the end of it, it does something very simple. It connects people together. So it's technology that connects in a way that watch tells you the time, so there we go. Right. So for us, you know, the key thing about this, it's quick, easy and trusted. So it's easy for teachers. They can go onto a massive database of volunteers. They can find people that suit their needs. It's quick, or virtually instantaneously. And it's trusted because it's promoted by bits of the government. It's promoted by various sort of employers, trade bodies, and the organisations representing teachers and head teachers. It is truly national. It means that any school can access any role model, particularly now, as you can do it virtually. And because it's technology-based, it's scalable and at low cost. And for me, the biggest difference is those children who wouldn't have access to role models either through their family networks or in their local communities. So it's really giving positive role models. And it gives chance. And when we started it, we weren't doing virtual. We thought about it, but only with COVID did we really accelerate our plans for that, because schools and employers were using virtual in a way they hadn't done before. So that really enables us to accelerate our plans. And, you know, I think that is really transforming how we've done things. So the art of it is like it's like online shopping or online dating or online looking for a hotel or booking an airline. You know, you go on, you search, and you like shopping, you invite people, put them in your shopping basket. It's the same technology actually a lot of companies use for things like online shopping. So teachers can go on, they can look at a map that's been in Manchester, or they can look at a list if they prefer that. They can then search, and they can search by a massive range of factors. They can search by the sector the volunteer works in. They can search, and you'll see here I've picked engineering and languages. They can search for the subjects they did at school. They can search for the languages they speak at home or at school. They can search for former students. They can look for people who've done apprenticeships, gone to university, diversity and inclusion, working with a disability. And they can now also do a sort of keyword search through their entire volunteers' job description and profile. So it really enables a very powerful search engine. And they can search people in their immediate area. So obviously, you know, if you want people to come in, that helps. And you can expand the radius from a 2 kilometer, 5 kilometer, 20 kilometer to see who's available locally. And then you can also do it virtually, which is really the game changer. So you can see there. And what you'll see is a list of people who live in your area or meet your criteria. And here we can see the example that we've got. There's sort of geoengineer, and we can add them to short. As we've added Fatima, we can then look at Fatima's profile of what she's written about herself. And obviously we're looking for someone to do with engineering. I think this is a real person. And then you can click and invite them. And then after that, the whole automated system reminds teachers to chase people up. It reminds volunteers to reply to emails, and it does all the scheduling for events. So if you set up an event at your school where you want volunteers to come in, you know, the whole thing is then automated. So it saves an enormous amount of time on that. And so the technology really, you know, it enables us to do real-time reporting on a massive range of criteria. This is very helpful for companies, for bits of government, highly customized reports. So we can look at, you know, and down to granular level of, in the UK, postcodes or similar zip codes, where depending where you are, local and regional level, different phases of education, but you'll see what it says on there. You can look around poverty, which is our proxy for free school meals. I know that's pretty common in the world. And then a lot of analysis by school level, so by pupil, teacher, and so on. So there's a huge amount of data, I think about 1,000 automated reports that we can run on that. And, you know, in summary, it means that in the UK, every school has direct access to volunteers. And we cover all levels, so some apprenticeship CEOs, all sort of sectors, archaeologists and zoologists. I think we're near like 4.5 million interactions now, so very much scalable. You can see the numbers there. And a number of countries are sort of following suit and doing something. Iceland have just launched their own version of Inspiring the Future last week, and they're rolling out to all schools. So it does something simple. It connects people together. The technology is quite clever, but the idea is very simple. I'm probably going to stop sharing now. There we go. Back to you, Young. Yeah.
Yeah, thank you, Nick, for that.
The whistle stop there.
Presentation. I don't know if we're getting any questions in the chat. So if you have any questions to our speakers, please feel free to drop them in the chat and we'll try to address as many as we can towards the Q&A session. But thank you for that, Nick. It's really good to hear about your work and how engaging employers is so powerful. Now I will turn to Juan José, and I don't know if we have been able to figure out something here. But do you have slides that you wanted to share? I forget.
Yeah. Hi, John. Really, thanks for the opportunity for us to share our experience and say hi to Nick. We meet like 4 or 5 years ago in London when we have a learning visit to UK, and we have really learned from their experience. I'm going to also share a small presentation, and let me share my screen.
Great, thank you. Yeah, we'd love to hear more about your work. So,
yeah. Mm-hmm. So it's when I just want to go a small step back, let's say, and just in order to think about a little bit about what is career guidance. And for my point of view, career guidance is really a complex and it's an evolving decision making. So when you think of something like this, that is no longer a linear or a predictable outcome process, it's like it's kind of an helicoidal process, let's say. And through your life, at the end, you are going to visit the same issue, but from a different level or a different perspective. So that makes you, if you put in a nutshell, as we are talking about identity and how you define your personal, your social, your professional identity, and it links to this question. So how we learn or teach to take decision, how we find out where we really like to do, and how we connect with the real world. This is the for us, this is the main three questions that we need to issue when do work with the students. So if we go a little bit on about our work, as Nick has highlighted, we also get from the OECD Dream Jobs report, and we have also do our small research in groups, and we really know that this number of only 10 fairly traditional occupations is really the average in the students. So if you get from this, and there are thousands of opportunities to choose, how can you connect them? That's the question that we ask ourselves when we go into the project. And we, as a foundation, our goal is to promote and networked guidance to improve young people's future. And networked may be the main word in this phrase, because we need to connect the dots. We need to connect the educational world and the world of work that are pretty fair, especially in Spain. That is where we are working on. And just to tell you a little bit about our work, we work with schools, public administration, other institutions, and of course, of public and private institutions to strengthen the school guidance. So we are working with, from 2020, we launched the Excellent School at Inspiran project with the support of JP Morgan, and we have involved more than 300 state-funded schools in three specific Spanish regions, you know, Madrid, Catalonia, and Aragon. And also we, in 2023, so it's like last year, we launched Empresas.inspiran.es, that is the web that we are going to present today. And the main strategy, the main focus is to position the company as a key player in the career guidance process, because then at the end, that's why we select the claim of Empresas que Inspiran, or inspiring companies in English, because we need to engage really with the companies in a culture where for them it's like they are not going to they think that in they don't have to do anything with a young student with only 14 years old. They are too young for them. They are looking more at a 20, 19, 21 years level student. So we need to awake them, and that's why we are looking to create high impact volunteering activities. That's, and volunteering is the main issue here. We need to engage with them to awakening this volunteer and dismantling this kind of stereotypes. And we do it with three essential. We take the decision, we focus on only three essential activities to awaken vocations. One is the workplace visit, the other is great conversation, and the third is a job shadowing. You can see that we are focusing in, let's say, the bread and butter of the career guidance, so the main three kind of activities that every student should do several times during the learning experience. And that's why we focus on only three in order to create, to increase the numbers and increase the quality of the experience, and try to work with the schools and the company from going from a standard workplace visit to an advanced one, where the experience is more engaging with the student, more experiential, and you can only not only see a technology or a facility, but also really know in small groups the volunteers that are working on this facility, on this technology. And when we talk about career talks, we also split into two, because it's a different perspective when you go to a schools in order to talk about your experience from the guidance perspective. So you are going to talk about your decision, your background, what you study and what you're doing now. But when you go to a schools to talk about a subject perspective, this is really different, because you are going to try to connect your experience with the subject. So you are like a co-teacher when we are going a little bit deeper in this experience later. Because if you analyze the teacher commitment or the teacher engagement in career guidance activities, they are in the top level of this slide. You can see job shadowing, the career conversation, the workplace visit. These usually are managed by the specialist, the career advisor, the career counselor, the one who is trained to be the connection between the school and the world of work. But if you go a little bit deeper and you go to activities that really link the learning experience through the curriculum with volunteers in a co-teaching or in a experiential conversation within your classroom, the teacher becomes really a guidance expert. And we need to take into account that at the end, the students are really exposed to the teacher. You have the average ratio that we have in different countries. In Spain, we have one career counselor every 700 more or less student. So that's a big number. So you need to engage really with the day by day learning experience, and that's why the teacher must be on a focus. And if you go a little bit deeper in this approach, when we talk about how these activities can be inside the classroom and how can a volunteer become a teacher for a day, it's like, the Talis report from the OECD is highlight that many teachers has never participate in collaborative professional learning activities with other, or never do co-teaching with other professionals. So we have a huge opportunity here to increase and connect the learning with the real world of work, and just to help teachers to become much more efficient in the way they support the students. So I am just finalizing my presentation. Just want to share with you the way we connect with the companies. As I mentioned, we look for the companies to be in the main field, to be a let's say a a key player for this project. So we make it, as also Nick has mentioned, we have to make it quite easier. Just in 10 minutes, they can create a profile on the website and they can start to offering opportunities to the schools. And as also as Nick has mentioned, all the opportunities are geolocated. So for a school, it's quite easy to understand if this opportunity is pretty near from the facilities, they can go by public transport and so on. And this is a key point. That's the accessibility and the time consuming for students and for teachers. And here I can share with you some data about our previous school year report. And as you can see, the technology in 2022, we do it, let's say, manual. And in 2023, we swap into this technology. So you can see how using this technology have let us just double, triple the numbers of volunteers, of companies, of activities, of school and students. And that's one of the main focus. So yeah, I want to leave time for the question. So thank you so much for this opportunity, John, and I give back the floor to yours.
Thank you so much for that insightful presentation as well. And it's really great to hear about your work and also how it relates to some of the work that we've been doing at the OECD with TALIS and PISA. So I'm just going to go a little bit away from technology because I just have kind of a general question about engaging employers. And Nick and Juan José, you can, you know, pitch in whenever. But you've talked about the importance of engaging employers and how powerful it can be. But have you had any challenges trying to engage employers? Like how can schools and teachers actually engage employers to play an active role in career guidance for students? Do you have any tips for that?
Yeah, for sure. Nick, I am sure that you have so many tips. But someone that I would like to highlight is you need to select which is the right sector. It's not the same experience when you connect with a company that is in a sector that is a lack of talent and they are struggling to get talent into the facility. So this is usually the kind of company that are willing to engage and they are going to understand that need to engage earlier. It's not only to wait for a 20 years old student finishing their degree or their dual vet or whatever. You need to engage with a 13, 12, 11 years, 9 years, as you show in the video. That's go really, really, it's a mindset. It's a change in the mindset for the company because they are not used to do that. They are used to receive students when they are finalizing their degree or the dual vet, and this is a change of paradigm, I think so.
Okay, great. And Nick, do you have anything else that you'd like to add to that?
Yeah, I mean, something comes back to self-interest. You know, why do people do things? Well, you know, if you were cynical, you'd say, well, there's a self-interest. And so what is a self-interest in companies? Well, I mean, it varies, doesn't it? You know, sometimes it's their future talent and therefore reaching out to schools to ensure they have the future talent. Sometimes it's because their staff are demanding it, because their staff care about CSR or inspiring young people or education or their communities. You know, some that they have government contracts where they have to be seen to be doing something to support education. But, you know, they've got to get something out of it. And whether that's either a feel-good factor for helping education, whether it's a way of spending philanthropy in an effective way, whether it's the staff having a good time and feeling really good and very positive. We did a report called The Value of Volunteering, which is on our website, which looked at what employers got out of supporting schools themselves. So a lot of it plays into what's in it for the schools. And I think, you know, our sort of thing is to get employers of any size. We don't say business, we say employers, because employers could be a university, they could be the OECD, I mean, they could be a third sector organization, they could be the health service, they could be three or four people working for themselves, or they could be a large multinational and everything in between. And I think for me, it's showing children, particularly from an early age, as you may know, we've done an awful lot on primary in the UK and internationally through the drawings and the looking at labour markets and what young children aspire to and the reality of the labour market. But it's really showing children what they can be and the different massive range of people out there that they can aspire to be and to get insights into their lives.
Right, thank you. And I guess if we kind of go back to the technology aspect of it, technology would support this kind of engagement for these engaging employers. Have you faced any challenges or issues when it comes to actually using certain technologies to do that? Have you found that sometimes it's just better to, you know, put away the technology and do things more in person or the other way around? Yeah, walk us through a little bit of your kind of challenges and issues that you've been facing. Mm-hmm. With this.
You want to start off there, Juan?
Yeah, in our experience, for example, we have tried to balance the technology experience and the real world, let's say, experience. And just to connect with a question that I have seen in the chat is that how can we ensure that the variety of sector is enough to the interest of the students? You need to connect with all the actors that is related to this. So the Chamber of Commerce, the Business Association, the Small Business Association. And that's why just technology is only a part of it. You need to be in the meetings. You need to be when they have a face-to-face meeting with a business or employer. And without technology, they talk as a person and say, okay, you have to do something with it. With this, we as a country have a struggling with this career guidance problem because the people that drop off the educational system are really, really high. So you need to balance the an easy technology and accessible technology with a strong network of a personal relationship, let's say.
Okay, great. The question raised by Ralph and that you have touched on, Juan José, it's important for students to really broaden their horizons because they can't be what they can't see. That's something that we often say at the OECD. So to help them kind of expand their view of work, one of the ways that we can do that is engaging employers through technology, but at the same time, having a good balance. Mm-hmm. Let's kind of talk about the schools a little bit. And I mean, you touched upon a little bit about teachers and how kind of every teacher needs to be a little bit of a guidance counselor because you've got 700, 800 students for one counselor. That's very difficult. But so then in your work, what kind of training and supports have you provided to schools and to education systems in order for them to actively engage with employers?
Yeah, for sure. We have developed two different trainings. One is a specific training for the career counselor or the career leader, let's say in the UK experience. So you need to have a really high specialist, let's say, and who has the knowledge and the skills to connect really and engage with the world of work. And that's one training, and it's a long, let's say, it's a more deep training. But we have also deployed, let's say, a massive and small training for teachers. And the goal or the approach in this training is how can you link your curriculum, your subject, with the things that are really happening outside in the world of work. And that's why we offer them videos, not only this one-to-one experience or learning visit or whatever, but when you need to something to plug and play, to use tomorrow at 9 a.m. when you start your classroom and you have 20 mates and need to say something and produce some learning experience then. So you need to have different kind of services and different kind of resources in order to then use the one that is more useful for the experience that you want to produce in the students.
Yeah, for sure.
Would it helpful if I just give a bit of a a sense of how the technology, you know, what actually happens in the classroom. Would that be useful? I can share a couple of slides.
Yes, that would be great. Yeah.
Maybe 2 minutes. I mean, that quote, you can't be what you can't see. It's a great quote. I know the OECD use it a lot. As you'll know, it's attributed to Marion Wright Edelman, who is the founder of the US Children's Defense Fund, an amazing activist for children's rights. I think she's now in her late 70s, but Marion Wright Edelman is really very inspirational person in the United States and around the world. Just showing a couple of slides of the tech. So you saw a bit. Oh, hang on. Is that showing?
Yep.
Is that showing? I can't see. Mm-hmm. Yep. So, you know, you've got the tech, you know, you've found the volunteers. So what do you actually do? So what we've tried to do is make it really simple for teachers to invite people in. So you've seen the tech, and then what the volunteers do, and again, we've refined this over about 12, 13 years, is the children sit with the volunteer, you can see what they do. They talk to them, they ask them questions. The volunteer doesn't need to do a presentation, they don't need to prepare, they just need to turn up, ideally with some props, or in that case, wearing a jumper of their company, which is Brompton Bikes, and sometimes with some pictures of Brompton Bikes or whatever. And the children ask questions. So it's a very, very simple format, one that works. Volunteers, probably 2 or 3 minutes about their life. So again, it's not a big ask of volunteers to do. Our ask really of volunteers is give an hour a year. That's our strap line, give an hour a year to go into a school near where you live or do it virtually. So that's primary. Let me see if that's, why is that moving on? We do a What's My Line, which is quite a fun one where the kids try and guess what people do, either on stage or virtually. And that shows a lot of the stereotyping, which you'll have seen in that video, which actually does feature, I think, 5 different countries, including South Africa. I know I've got a question from someone from South Africa. And there's an Italian version coming out shortly as well. So again, it's a fun, and you know, it's a fun, but it's got a serious point, because you see these people, they go off stage, they come back on, and you assume that, you know, you can see those people there, you assume what they do, and actually they often do something completely different. So it's a challenging stereotypes. And then the virtual, that really gives the sort of scale, again, similar sort of format to engage people in the workplace. Why is this not? In fact, there's going, there's the OECD, I think there is Andreas talking to kids in Switzerland with someone from Africa, someone from England, and someone from France joining in to multi-school activities. And then through, I don't know why anything is not working. And then in secondary, the sort of things that you and I've been talking about, the standard things. And again, the virtual, so I'm going backwards now, the workplace and so on. I'm going to stop sharing now. But, you know, it just gives a sort of sense of the range of, you know, the technology is good to connect people, but it's then actually what happens which makes a difference. So our technology is connecting people. It's not doing anything special other than doing that.
And that also shows that you don't need anything super fancy in order to get people to be connected. You could just use a simple chat function. You could just do videos to get students to kind of, you know, get an idea of different careers and engage with the employers. So yeah, that's great.
I mean, we've had schools in rural, actually rural Ghana's got actually very good internet connection, better than some parts of the UK actually, so that's not but you know, they've been doing that. You know, it started off a few years ago where we had a phone and we did basically a WhatsApp call with the teacher, then we connected the you know, to a computer, and they all sat around the computer, then they had a computer screen and they put it on the computer screen, you know, so you can be anywhere in the world really, as you can be on your WhatsApp, FaceTime, you know. And we've had people from opposite ends of the world, so we've had people in New Zealand talking to kids in the UK and vice versa, and as long as you can get the time zone right, I mean, we've got people from all over the world here, I can see. So what is stopping us talking to kids anywhere in the world, as long as you don't mind the times is friends, you know. So it doesn't matter where you live, you can connect to role models wherever they are. And I think that's a very powerful, certainly for countries to actually to systematically think, right, in our country, we want every child to be able to access role models. How do you do that? Well, technology is clearly the answer to do it at scale and low cost.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. And Did you have to provide any training to the employers themselves, to these role models?
I mean, we've got a platform with huge, again, anyone who's interested, we can share, you know, we're very happy to share with different countries how we've gone about it, and you can collaborate and see what we've done. I mean, the basics of how people talk to each other in every country is pretty much the same. We have done lots of, you know, guidance for teachers. We've done lots of guidance for employers, a few do's and don'ts. But again, we're trying to keep it simple. So there is, you know, we've done webinars for people who've not spoken in primary school before or secondary, but nervous. But often it's, you know, a 1 or 2 minute YouTube clip saying, if you're going to do this, here are, you know, two or three tips to do it. You know, we've really emphasized that, you know, employers don't need to spend time preparing and doing lots of presentations and speaking to an hour of children, because very few people can talk to kids for any length of time and engage them. But they can answer questions from kids about, you know, what was their favorite job, you know, or what they did at school, what they like about their job, what their job entails. Do they use maths? Do they use languages? Do they work in a community? What's their team like? What's their office like? You know, they can talk about their lives, and that's really easy. And so that's what we've tried to do.
Yeah, well, that's great, because they can really get those first-hand accounts of what it's really like to work in that position. Now, Juan José, have you also experienced any particular training you've had to provide to employers or for the technology?
Yeah, I really agree with Nick, and I think that we need to make it easier. And we also use the same approach, some tips, some webinars, and so on. And just to highlight some idea, is that I think that we have here really a huge opportunity, because everyone can become an inspiring professional to the student. So this is a kind of different CSR approach or volunteer approach, because some kind of volunteer need a really high specialist, and not everyone can become a volunteer. But I think that specifically in this field, nearly everyone could be a volunteer and engage with the school near the neighbor or near the facility where they work. And this is really a huge message, because we need thousands of people that give an hour or give 2 hours to the schools. And we need to make it easier and make it really broad. And John, I would like to, I don't know if you from the OECD have this on your mind, but as you did the dream jobs research, that, as you can see, is really helpful for us, because I think that any NGO that work in this field use this data. Have you in mind the idea of do a research of how many professions knows on average a teacher?
No, I don't think we have that angle to our work yet, but that's definitely something that we can consider, because we are planning to do a kind of dream jobs too. So I think that would be a really interesting perspective to kind of...
Yeah, because at the end, and obviously when you are in the primary, your role model, your main role model is your teacher.
Mm-hmm.
More than any other professional outside the school. When you grow up, you add more role models, but in the beginning, it's only your teacher, or it's your first. And that's why in primary, many kids want to become a teacher. And then when they grow up, they avoid this decision.
Yeah.
So if we give them more resources and more tips or more a broader variety of how many professionals are creating today, are appearing today, that we have a really high impact in the students' point of view.
Yeah. And I could even just say, from a personal experience as an adult, I don't know if I know or have friends from as many professions as I think I should have. So yeah, I think you're right. That would be very interesting. Thank you for that idea. And I think we just have one last question from Raf again. This is for Nick. And Raf is asking, do you educate teachers on how they can help their students actually learn from these activities?
I mean, ours is, we often say, is designed by teachers for teachers. And you know, there's nothing better than, you know, a teacher who's done something with their own students where their students have benefited, whatever activity that may be, and some of the things we're going to see over this symposium. But, you know, where a teacher has done something with a group of students that's been motivating and inspiring and easy to talk, then to share that with other teachers to say, I did this with these students and it really helped them. And I think that's, you know, sometimes we have teachers doing webinars, sometimes we just get clips on YouTube, sometimes we get them doing Q&As, various things. But it's very much, teachers tend to listen to teachers, as we know. And so that's, we've got a very powerful network. I think we've got about 24,000 teachers signed up. So we're trying to use some of those to talk to other teachers as a sort of community, really, which I think is far better than me talking to them, to be honest.
Okay. I'm just going to slowly wrap up now. I think I'm just going to go through the chat. Okay, so we have Lechigo, who is asking about your platform, Nick. And it looks like they're doing something similar in South Africa and would like to speak to you about the platform. So maybe...
Yeah, I think I've sent a message back to them, yeah. Okay, so great. Again, we've done a sort of paper how we've gone about it, which we've shared with a number of quite a lot of countries already, because as I say, the basic things of connecting is pretty universal. So if people can benefit from what we've done, that's good. If they can improve it, which I'm sure they can, that's good as well. You know, our focus as a charity is to help young people achieve their potential wherever they are in the world.
Great. And we also have on Odyssey have featured Juan José's work. So do check out the Odyssey link as well. Okay. So I guess as we wrap up here, I'll just ask the two of you to kind of share a last 1 minute key takeaway or message that has stood out from today. So shall we start with Juan José?
Yeah, sure. Well, I think that for me, the main challenge here is to help students to define their identity. You know, there is now many students struggling to take decision and to select an option to become a professional. And they are, quite of them, they are scary of the decision-making process. And it's like we need to create this learning pathway within the school experience. You need to train the kids to take decisions, to start making a decision process along their experience in the schools. So the earlier you start with this, the stronger and the biggest outcome that you will get out of it.
Thank you. And Nick?
Well, you know, beginning on that, I think starting early, we did a report called Starting Early, not a very imaginative title, where we looked at evidence from around the world about the impact of starting from sort of 6 and 7 year olds. So I think I would be advocating those early interventions are key, because when you look at what kids aspire to around the world, as John said, you know, actually for girls, teacher is normally the first choice, and for boys, it's footballer. But again, the jobs they're choosing are often very narrow and based on, you know, stereotypes. We've got some report coming out in Sweden, I think maybe tomorrow actually, and that's very interesting because that's showing actually the increasing influence of social media on children on TikTok and things like that, on children's career choices, which have even less in common with the labour market than they did. And I think that's where schools and governments have a real agency, because they can help show children what the reality of the jobs are, because either they're reliant on their parents or carers, their immediate community, their neighbours, TV, or increasing social media. So they're not getting a very realistic view of the labour market, and that's something that schools, ideally backed by governments, because their ability to do stuff at scale, can do and should do.
Yeah, great. Thank you. Thank you very much, Nick and Juan José. We learned a lot from you today. I mean, I've certainly learned a lot, and you've both given us plenty to think about. And my apologies for the video audio. thing again. But I believe Nick has sent a link to the video so you can watch it. And I do encourage you to watch it. It is very powerful. It's very good. And also, you may have seen from our chats, if you want to share about what you've learned today in this discussion, you could also use your social media channels. I think there's a hashtag. I think it's hashtag Future Dreaming 2024. And yeah, so thank you very much to everyone. And I hope you will continue to join us this afternoon for continued interesting and stimulating discussions. So we have a lunch break now. But then after the lunch break, there will be a digital technology and career guidance fair. And that also promises to be very informative. And it's going to provide practical examples. And so, yeah, see you there. Thank you very much again. And have a wonderful day, afternoon, evening, morning, and see you soon.
Thank you so much.
Bye.